Tang, I'm a former dean of the College of Science from 100 years ago, as you can see. And I'm substituting for Dean White, who unfortunately could not be with us this evening. So welcome to the Frontiers of Science, the longest running lecture series in the history of the University of Utah. And we're celebrating our 50th anniversary in this lecture series this year. It is my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Dan Nocera. Dr. Nocera is Patterson Rockwood Professor of Energy at Harvard University. He's widely recognized as the world leading researcher in renewable energy. He recently accomplished a solar fuel process that captures many of the elements of photosynthesis, and he has now translated this science to produce an artificial leaf, which was named by Time magazine the innovation of the year in 2011. He has since achieved solar to hydrogen efficiency greater than 10%. Now, I could literally go on for another 15 minutes and talk about him and his background, but I won't do that. I'll briefly summarize a couple of things. He's, of course, been well recognized and has numerous awards, including the Lee Ann Kahn Prize for Renewable Energy, the United Nations Science and Technology Award from the American Chemical Society Inorganic Chemistry Prize. He's, of course, a member of both the U.S. National Academy of Sciences and the American Academy of Sciences. He earned his bachelor's degree at Rutgers University. His PhD at Caltech. He's had close to or over 150 PhD graduate students and postdoctoral students. Very good one. I had one of his people who was just out of this world. He's published over 400 papers, gave over 850 lectures. He's founded a company called Sun Catalytics, which has now been overtaken by and run by Lockheed Advanced Energy Storage. So please welcome our speaker, Professor Dan Nocera.
Thank you, Peter.
You have a thing?
Thanks.
Oh, you have run it.
So thank you, Peter, and Henry. Henry, sorry he can't be here. I've been in contact with him even at 11:30 on the airplane last night. We were emailing each other. And also for University of Utah for being here. Also, Henry gave me a totally different view of what I should be speaking and who I was speaking to. And I see some people are here from the public, I'm guessing. And there's undergraduates and freshmen, and then there's a bunch of hardcore chemists and scientists here. So it's always fun to give these talks, and I'm going to touch on everything. So when you hear me getting too technical, just zone out. And I'll tell you when to wake up again. And then when you hear me being, I'm going to start off with a philosophy slide. You can zone out scientists if you don't want to hear that. So you just fall asleep and wake up when you want, and I won't be offended. I'll just tell you that right now. So, and what Henry asked me to speak about, and that's this title, and I'm going to explain it, about what a university should be doing in energy. That was what his agenda item was. And then, then we have one Henry supporter here. And then after I got here, everybody will say, what the heck is Henry talking about? He wants you to come talk about science to a general lay audience. And so I'm going to mix it all together. And I will talk about this, and you'll see why. So first I'll start off with geology. This is the Holocene. So there's epochs. So you even get there, there's already controversy. Is it an epoch or an epoch? It depends if you're a scientist or a geologist. But there are epochs, and they're not to say geologists aren't scientists. I'm saying non-geologists. I'm sorry, geologists in the audience. And so you're living in the Holocene, which is recent whole. And what that means, and I'll give students a hint, when you give these talks, what you do most of the time is Think of what you want to say, then go on Google Images and find pictures that are evocative of what you're trying to say. So here, this is trying to say she looks like a piece of algae in the water, and the Holocene is when people showed up on Earth. But there weren't, in society, but there weren't enough of us to alter life systems. So everything was green and happiness. And then we showed up. And that's called the Anthropocene. That's a made-up epoch or epic. And that is discussed in the early 70s, that there's so many of us now that we've begun altering the biosphere just with human activity. So that's what the Anthropocene means. To be truthful, you're living in this, which is a recent term, but you're really in this geological part of society. Now, I used to be most of my career at MIT. And people ask me what the difference is between MIT and Harvard. At MIT, you get to just get up every day and be science nerd, and everybody loves you. If you go to Harvard and you're science nerd, they try to put you somewhat close to an insane asylum, and they try to board you off from the rest of the campus. So to get the rest of the campus on board, I decided I had to invent a new epic. So I'm going to call it the Sustainocene. So now the humanists are listening to me at Harvard. That's the only reason I did this, was just to be listened to by most of the campus. So I'm going to call it the Sustainocene. But I want to explain what I mean by it. There's actually a meaning behind this. And that is, it sounds like sustainability. And when you think about sustainability, you think about this: blue planet and greenness, healthiness to the planet. And that's not what I mean by the Sustainocene. What I mean by the Sustainocene is it's impossible to have this if you have this, which is poverty. All right? And so I'm going to make the claim, and this is what I mean by the Sustainocene, you can't have a green and healthy planet and what you think about sustainability if you have poor people on the face of the planet. And if you don't take care of them properly, you can't have this. So that's what the Sustainocene means. Now, that's in words, but I told you I'm a scientist, so I'm going to muck up everything as usual with an equation. And I'm going to now give you an equation to prove this. All right, so that's my next task here. But before I do that, I want to get to this philosophical thing, and it's called solipsism. So what does solipsism mean? It's actually a philosophical term that one's own mind is the only thing that surely exists. And so what to the extreme is, right now, none of you exist. But like, this is philosophers, by the way. I don't believe this. I actually believe you exist. But none of you actually exist right now unless in my mind I allow you to exist. If I decided right now to say you don't exist, you would all evaporate from this room. So this goes way beyond egocentrism. This is like you don't even exist unless I allow you to exist in my mind. And that's what solipsism is. Now, why is this word so important to the Sustainocene? And that's because there's a truth to it, that we only deal with the world that we see, that we allow ourselves to see, and we see what's around us, ourself. And the problem with that is, in that self, the world exists, and that three means there's only 3 billion of you who live in that world. And that's the world that has wealth. So everything I do, basically, is for a world of wealth, and that's the world I live in and I see. And the problem with energy is there's 6 billion poor that we don't see every day, all right? And it's going to be those people, the part we can't see and we don't deal with, that are going to describe and drive the energy equation for the future. Right? And if we don't give them the right flavor of energy, if you think you're having problems now, give them what we're doing and see how you'll be living in 6 billion years, or in 40 years from now. So these 6 billion people, and it's not that they don't exist. Right now there's 3 billion that are poor. 1.4 billion, as I speak, have never seen an electron in a wire, which shocks people. But there's 1.4 billion people on the face of the planet that hasn't seen one electron go through a wire. And we plug things in the wall all the time, and we get angry when our phone isn't charged. So think about it. So there's 1.4 that haven't seen energy. The other 1.6, very low energy users. And then there's 3 billion new people coming in the next 40 years. So take your age and add 40 to it. Thank God I'm going to be gone, because wait till you see what you're in for. But there's a lot of students here and young people, and this will be your life that you're living. And I'm going to give you real data. And this is what you're up against. And you can decide whether you want to do something about it or not. So that's why I'm saying you need to take care of these 6 billion. Now I said I'm going to show you by equations what I mean. And that is, this isn't an equation, it's an identity relation. So that means what I say here is exactly that. It's not a function like you put in a parameter and get a variable and you get out an answer. So this is that is that. So energy is this. And that says to calculate energy, which I can do, I just need to know population. So how many people there are. GDP, gross domestic product per capita. I just have to look on Google, look in a country, and see what the GDP per person is. If I know that number, I know the number of people. And then this is an interesting number, energy intensity. That means energy needed to drive your GDP. So that's a code word for conservation. So sometimes you hear the word conservation, conservation. I can actually quantify it. So say this year, I'll use the US as an example, we hit a GDP. I know how much energy you used. Next year, if you hit the same GDP and use less energy, you conserved. And by the amount of less energy you use to hit that GDP, I can tell you exactly how much you've conserved. If you use more energy, you didn't conserve. So by using that metric, I can quantify conservation. And if you multiply that together, that goes away, energy is energy. So that's it. So if I know these three parameters, I can calculate global energy use. There's other things you can do. Let's do it for America. First off, did you ever calculate how much energy you use? Well, let's do this. You use 2,000 calories, we'll say, of food you eat today. So that's 2,000 calories, that's energy. I can put that in energy. But I'm going to talk about energy in terms of power. So if I put that over seconds, energy per unit time, that's power. So when you talk about a 100-watt light bulb at home, that's power, a 100-watt light bulb. It's using energy, but it's on all the time. So you don't need to worry about how much energy did you use, as Nocera talking about, today or for a year. It's burn rate. How much energy you're burning per unit time. So if you eat 2,000 calories, where's the freshmen? I know we have some freshmen because I just spoke to you guys. I want you to do this. I'm going to give you the answer, but you're going to calculate it for your advanced honors course. So if you eat 2,000 calories, that's in 24 hours. And so energy over time, you can calculate your power. So do you know how bright a light bulb you are? You're all 100-watt light bulbs. I'm serious. Every one of you right now is a 100-watt light bulb. But that's that. And that's why I need to know population, because there's an energy value to keep you alive. But you live in the U.S., so I can calculate how much energy you use at home. That's another 1,000 watts on average. So now you're worth 1,100 watts. And then you do manufacturing, you drive cars and we manufacture and there are power plants. I know how much energy that is per your GDP. I can look that up. So it turns out if you're an American, you're 11,100 watts. You only need 100,000 at home, 10,000 manufacturing around you. So you're 1,100 watts. And then there's this conservation number. All right, so that's how you do this calculation. So I did that. A few years ago, I looked, by the way, I don't do research anymore. My research is I do Google plots. I'm going to show you lots of Google plots and Google calculations, and you could do them at home. You could go on the web and look up GDPs of every country and know their populations, and then you can calculate this out. And I did. And I found out in 2012 the world is burning a 16 trillion watt light bulb. So the bulb's on all the time, and that's what you're burning globally as a population. I did it for every country, and then I just added up the total energy use. It's that simple, using that equation. And I can extrapolate to the future. I'm going to get back to this. And when I do that, so I extrapolated to 2050, you're going to be burning a 32 trillion watt light bulb. All right, so you're going to double your energy use in 40 years. So then you can say, and by the way, now 80% of the 16 trillion watts, the way you keep that 16 trillion watt light bulb on, you already know, you use coal, oil, gas, fossil fuels. So that's what's feeding the light bulb to keep it on. And I just told you, if you're going to get to 32 doing that, even if you don't think we're having problems, by then you'll think we're having problems. I'll just leave it at that. I don't want to get into that argument right now. So, or just think of it this way. I grew up in New York City, so I'm a worrier. So if you just look at a highly neurotic human being. That's the other way you can think about it. And so in 40 years from now, you're going to be at 32 trillion watts, terawatts. And I could start calculating where energy is going to come from. And I did in this article and got lots of people angry at me. But I wasn't trying to make people angry at me. So first off, let's do this one. Biomass, the Iowa corn farmers got really angry at me for doing this calculation. You get death threats. That's always fun to have happen. And all I did is I did something very simple. I didn't even say corn. I just said I'm going to take the entire arable part of the world and I'm going to put the fastest growing crops. In a crop, I can make CH2O, one carbon, two hydrogens, and an oxygen. That's carbohydrate. So I can take the entire arable planet, leave 2,000 calories for 10 billion people, take all the rest, and if you take CH2O, carbohydrate, and burn it with oxygen the entire way, you get CO2 and water. And I know how much energy is released in that. I know how much stuff I grew, so I can calculate how much energy you get from burning the fastest growing crops growing everywhere on the face of the planet, leaving all you guys 2,000 calories a day. 5 to 7 terawatts, depending on what crop cycle and crop I use. So you can only get 6 terawatts on average from all biomass. And we can't do that. Most of the biomass is cellulose and lignin, so we don't even know how to do it. But I can do it on paper. I go the full thermodynamic cycle, the full energy content. So even what you can't do right now, if you were able to, you get 6. You need 16 more. Say I want half from nuclear. By the way, I like every one of these because they have no minimum carbon in it. Right? So that's why I chose these. How about nuclear? Look at this one. To get 8, to get half of what I'm going to need, you need to build one nuclear power plant every day and a half forever. So that sounds kind of stupid. It sounds like I'm being really weird. But let's do a calculation. This is what scientists do. When you build a nuclear power plant, you build it at a gigawatt. You don't like building them bigger because they can get dangerous. And if something goes wrong, it's already bad enough. So you limit a nuclear power plant at a gigawatt. I want 8 terawatts. 8 terawatts divided by a gigawatt. If you don't know the units, I'll do it for you. 8,000. So that means you got to build me 8,000 nuclear power plants in 40 years to get 8 terawatts. 8,000 divided by 40, 200. I'm just going to say there's 400 days in a year. Scientists, we always round up. make our calculation easy. So if I have to build 200 power plants in a year, that's every 1.5 days you've got to build me a nuclear power plant, a gigawatt, to get 8. But I said forever. Why did I do that? Because you can't run nuclear power plants forever. You run them on 50-year cycles because they get dangerous after 50 years. So then you've got to close down the one that you just built, I'm going to let you build them for 40 years. I'm going to give you a 10-year rest. Then you got to close down the one you built me in a day and a half, and you got to rebuild it. So to maintain an 8-terawatt base load with nuclear, you're going to be building nuclear power plants every day and a half on a 40-year cycle, 10-year rest, keep building. And I haven't even, we haven't had to have a discussion of nuclear waste and all that stuff. Just make a decision as a society. It's not for me to do. That's the calculation. Okay? And you can keep doing this. How about wind? By the way, if you have it, use it. But here's the easy calculation. If you can put your hand through your energy source this easily, don't count on it. All right. So, sun, I just did the calculation. I know how much solar radiation is hitting it. So this is why we're all gaga happy with the sun. And this is true. In 1 year, this is in the article I published in 2006 in Proceedings of the National Academy, more sun hits the face of the planet in 1 year than we're using in in 1 day than we're using an entire year globally. So that's why we like the sun. But I like the sun for a different reason, because it has to do with the poor, and I'm going to get to you in a minute about that. Okay, so then you can say, if I did a 16-terawatt calculation for the future, the one thing I swept under the rug was this conservation number. I was talking about people and GDP, but I left the last term off. So I got to tell you what I assumed in my calculation. I assumed that the energy intensity, meaning all the energy you support the planet with right now, the GDP of the planet, you will save in 40 years. Meaning science and technology will make so many great inventions that in 40 years from now, you will be conserving 16 terawatts. And you still need 16 more. And now I don't have to go through and tell you why. It's because there's 6 billion people who are going to be here who aren't using any energy right now. So you better conserve it all, and it's still not going to be enough for them, and we're going to need 16 more. So that's the moral imperative piece. It's not really a moral imperative. It's just, it's a duty. You better take care of the poor. It's that simple. Okay? But we do live in this world, too, and we should take care of that part of the world. And so the first thing I want to another thing I want to impress upon you, when you talk about energy, and it drives me a little bit nutty, is people just make it all sound like one thing. So you almost have to be Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde when you talk about energy. And always ask, are you talking about energy for, what does this mean, non-legacy world? I like that better than the poor. What that means is there's a part of the world that hasn't built a huge energy infrastructure like we have in this country. So if you've built a big energy infrastructure in this country, you want to use it. So the way you bring renewable energy to this energy infrastructure is you piggyback to it. It's built. What can I invent that I can put onto that infrastructure to help renewables get into the business? So you think that way. And if you're going to do stuff in energy and you're going to do it as a university, you say, are we going to do that? And you can. The other piece is the poor or the non-legacy world hasn't built an energy infrastructure. So the card deck is wider. You could bring in new technologies easier. So when I think about energy, I think about non-legacy and legacy. And then there's another thing I do. I say, I know I'm not going to be able to go up against this huge energy infrastructure. It's centralized. So like I told you, I have to invent things to go to it. And that's what I did with Sun Catalytics. Lockheed Martin built it, took it over. And as I speak right now, Lockheed Martin's building a thing called the flow battery that's going to be bigger than this room that will sit on a power company's floor from the stuff we invented in Sun Catalytics. You will have solar panels on your roof. You'll generate electricity, it will go over the wires you use now, it will sit in the flow battery that Lockheed Martin built for the power company. They'll store it, and then at night, when you need it, they're going to send it back to your house. And because they'll know how much energy they store and they know buyback price, they're even going to help you put solar panels on your roof. And you're going to think they helped you, and then they'll just put it in the buyback price over 10 years, and you'll end up paying for it. And that's how the world should work. I have no problems with that. And Lockheed Martin should make all the money because they assume the risk to build my flow battery. And so that's one way. But I don't want to talk about that today. I want to talk about the 6 billion people, the non-legacy world. And I'm going to argue that should be low capex because they don't have a lot of money. So you can't have, we'll talk about this in a minute, low capital expenditure and should be distributed. Now, this is for Henry. He said, tell me why a university, you know, Sarah, should be doing any of this. And it's really easy. And so first, for the legacy world, there's really no credible market driver. Unless you guys as a population want to price carbon. By the way, price carbon, code word, tax on carbon, but you don't say the word tax. So I'm trying to get tax by you by saying pricing carbon. But what I'm saying is you put a tax on carbon. That then makes it carbon more expensive so you can bring new technologies in. But if you don't want to do that, and right now this country doesn't really want to do that, that's fine. Then there's no market driver for industry to do this type of research. So the reason why you need a university, and you want to do this research because someday that might happen, and you need to make sure all the research is done so then industry can run with it and capitalize on it. So even for the legacy world, you want to be in the energy game, especially in renewables, because the industry has no market driver. It's a losing money proposition for them to be in it right now. That's perfect for us. We're not out to make money. We don't have a bottom pay line for us. We have the luxury of not talking to Wall Street every 4 months. So that's why universities should do it. For the non-legacy world, there's no government or industry that's really that's focused on the poor because there's not money there. And in the legacy world, that's the solipsism idea. It's hard to convince a U.S. federal taxpayer that their money should be used to give energy to the poor, and it's to their benefit. And I understand that. I don't complain. So I just understand that parameter space. Again, universities have the ability to do that. So for both legacy and non-legacy, universities should do it. The second reason is you guys just got the equation. I said N GDP per capita energy GDP. Now I'm going to put it in terms of university language. N humanist, sociology, culture. You know some of the people who speak to me the most right now at Harvard? You know who I talk to about population? I don't have them listed there. The Divinity School. Guess who deals with the poor a lot and they make decisions? The poor make decisions. Religion. You can learn a lot from your Divinity School about how the poor make decisions. Unfortunately, my religion's energy. But I can learn from the Divinity School. And I talk to the Divinity School because they spend a lot of time with the poor, as does the Graduate School of Education, the Graduate School of Design, which is how do you design cities, or how do you design places for people to live, especially that haven't built it yet. And of course, the School of Public Health. At Harvard, there's the Harvard Kennedy School and the Harvard Law School. That's this middle number, economics, policy, and law. Anything I say has to go by international law agreements that I want to do. You'll see what I'm doing in a minute. And then energy intensity, science, engineering, innovation. That's in the Faculty of Arts and Sciences. I work with people in the Harvard Medical School. You'll see why in a few minutes. And Harvard Business School does a lot with innovation. So when you start looking at this, there's no company that sets themselves up this way. There's no federal agency that sets themselves up this way. They set themselves up separately. Only in a university do you set yourself up where it's seamless across a university to have all pieces working. So by the end of the talk, I'm going to show you something I'm doing based off all the science I'm doing, talking to these people and these people that could only exist and I could only go this fast as I'm going in a university. If I were in a company or a federal government agency, it would never work. So that's another reason for university. Okay, Henry, tell Henry I met my charter for this talk and now I'm going on. If you don't buy it, I can't help you. But I'm going to show you by example what I'm talking about. So I want to do energy for the poor, I told you, because that's where the energy is really needed. And I want to get them the right flavor. I don't want to do carbon. And I'm telling you, it's got to be low CapEx, low capital expenditure, and distributed. And I'm telling you, for that, it has to be simple engineering. And because simple engineering is low cost, and the translation is lightweight and highly manufacturable. Now, what do I mean by that? So here's one of my research discoveries. So this is what I do. I sit on Google. I make these plots. I run into the lab. I tell my students, look what I just discovered. You really do feel old. They kind of escort me back to my office. They say, go back in there, and we'll just keep doing important research. So this is how my group works. So they don't like listening to me. You're a captured audience. So you're going to listen to my discovery from Google. And all I did is I put manufacturing cost and I divided it by weight. And I don't care about what type of technology. I'm just saying, how much does the thing weigh? And then how much did it cost to manufacture? Then over here, I'm putting annual production volume. And this works for almost anything that's machines that you build. Now, what doesn't it work for? It doesn't work for IT. Information technology. You can put a bunch of kids in a room at Harvard and they can make Facebook and they can do Microsoft Word. That's a low CapEx endeavor, and so it doesn't work for IT. Doesn't work for pills. So doesn't work for pharma. Because what are you paying for with the pill? You don't realize what you're paying for. You're paying for hope. So there's this massive overvalue cost to the drug that you hope will work, that will solve cancer and make you live forever. We can have that discussion about, you can go into US actuary tables and see how much you spend on the last 2 years of life. So I've asked, why do we get not to share it? So think about this, in the last 2 years of life, I decide how the money's gonna be spent, not the insurance companies or hospitals, and then I get half of it to do what I want, and the government can keep half. But I want to get into that argument. You can see why you want to talk to the other parts of the university. That would be a good health model. Just think about it, the most intimate thing in your life will be when you're dying, but you don't get to share in the wealth of it. So I might want to take half my money and go do something with it and then not use it on me. I don't want to get there. I can see a lot of people are looking at me right now going, when's this guy going to be done? So I'm going to say, I'm not going to do that. So forget about the hope thing. I don't care. It doesn't work. It doesn't work for commodity chemicals, but it works for machines. So anything you manufacture, now you can say these kind of all look the same. Why does a Boeing 77 cost a little bit more? There's a lot of IT chips on that thing to keep it going. It works for this. I'm not kidding you. I found out McDonald's has a chief technology officer. You should know that. Stunning to me. They have a CTO, and I asked the CTO to just tell me what the weight of the patty was, the cheese, the tomato, the lettuce, and the bun. $10 per pound. Not kidding you. The only thing is I put $100 million. He told me it's near infinity, their manufacturing volume. So I've now equated a hamburger to a car without knowing anything about sophistication. Now, why is this such an important graph to understand? Because the way you build energy is you build one big, heavy, centralized thing, and when I multiply, you can never be cheaper than $10 per pound. When I multiply $10 per pound by the weight of your infrastructure, like the power plant, it comes out to $2 billion. So how is our energy system market set up? I built it. I now own energy. You don't. I got investors. I put $2 billion into it. And now this is called return on investment. I put the $2 billion capital expenditure out. And then I got my economists, and we figure out how much money I'm going to make by selling the energy to you and get a return on my original $2 billion investment and then make money. So that's how our current energy system works. And like I said, it's a lot of money that you've already paid off. So I'm at the University of Chicago Economics Department. They are currently just calculating the current infrastructure costs of fossil fuels immediate, like wires in the ground and power plants. And they're already at $8 trillion in the US. And guess what? You paid it all off. in the last 100 years. It's free to you. So that's why I don't get mad. The oil companies aren't trying to stop me. There's no conspiracy. It's not legislators are out to get you and not have renewables. It's not that complicated. It's that as a society, you live in a society that basically have put $10 trillion into the system, and that's totally free for you right now. You have a legacy, and whether you admit it or not, it's very hard for you to walk away from a $10 trillion legacy. So it's good to try to make that $10 trillion structure better, burn carbon better, and then retrofit it with renewables, all right? But why doesn't this model work in the poor parts of the world? Because they don't have money. So first, they don't have the capital expenditure. And if you got investors together, they're not going to invest there because their return on investment is going to be 20 or 30 years from now. So that's why they don't have energy, because this model doesn't work for the poor because of this market driver of ROI. And in the US, ROI is now down to like 4 or 5 years. If you don't have a good ROI in 4 or 5 years for your, you know, your retirement fund and you're running a company, gone. Right? So here's my simplicity in life. If this part of the graph isn't working, what did I do? Turn your eyes over here and make the fast food McDonald's hamburger of energy. So let me now, I'm serious. I'm going to prove to you I made the McDonald's hamburger of energy. Now, what's the market model of McDonald's in the current energy infrastructure market model? McDonald's, how would they run it, their company, if they did energy model? Did you ever think of it? They would make one huge hamburger. You guys would all drive to it, take a bite out of it, and then drive home. I'm serious. Think about that. That's how McDonald's would build their energy infrastructure. What did McDonald's do? They make a bunch of little hamburgers. It's distributed. You just go and get it, and then you go home. I'm serious. This is how we thought a few years ago. I wish I could tell you we were more sophisticated. So what type of science am I going to invent to make a hamburger? And I'm going to hand it out to all of you, and then you can use it to generate energy. Now, you don't generate energy. You're going to convert energy. You don't make energy. That's the other thing. So the first thing is, if I'm going to have a distributed energy supply that nobody's going to own, that's why I like the sun. Because if you're a poor person in India, or you're sitting outside here, everybody has access to the same energy supply. So that's important. I got to do a McDonald's here. So that's why I choose the sun. It's lightweight and it's highly distributed. Now, how does photosynthesis work? The way it works is, remember what you learned in grade school, sunlight plus water plus carbon dioxide makes biomass, carbohydrate plus oxygen. That's what you learned. But there's something interesting about this. The leaf takes water and splits it to oxygen and hydrogen. That's what it uses the sun for. The piece we think about photosynthesis, wood, which is pretty amazing, think about photosynthesis. It takes air, sunlight, and water. Air, I have trouble getting my hands around. Sunlight, I have my trouble getting hands around. Water, at least I can see, and it builds all of this. I'm serious, think about it. It's amazing. So what it does is it splits water to oxygen and hydrogen. It then, in the night, takes hydrogen and combines it with carbon dioxide to make biomass. And that's really important, because in the design of my hamburger and finally doing photosynthesis, I free myself up where I need the sun versus where I don't need the sun. Now, how does this work? Why did photosynthesis choose water splitting? What it's really doing is you use sunlight to take water, the bonds of water, low energy bonds, and the sunlight goes in there and rearranges the bonds to hydrogen and oxygen, high energy bonds. So that's what sunlight's doing. So you're storing sunlight in the rearranged bonds of water to make hydrogen and oxygen. And then at night, that high energy hydrogen, which is bottled sunlight, gets combined with CO2 to make biomass. how much energy is in rearranged bonds of water? If I could, so now here's going to be the thought experiment. Can I make a little hamburger that you all own, get some water, have sunlight, and we got to operate on water? How much energy could I store in the rearrangement of water's bonds? So this is an equation to tell you if I had one mole, one unit of water, how much energy I could store. That's the Harvard swimming pool. The hardest thing with this calculation is finding out there's 2.8 million liters of water in that swimming pool. So if I now have a hamburger that can operate on that pool and split it to hydrogen and oxygen per second. Now, I'm not doing this globally. I'm not using the water up, because after you make hydrogen and oxygen, what are you going to do? Recombine it and get the energy out, and then you get water back. So I'm just cycling it. Sunlight in, break water to hydrogen, oxygen. You use it at night. It's now you have the hydrogen and oxygen, recombine it, get the energy out, you get the water back. So I'm not using up this water. I'm just going through it. If I make a hamburger and operate on that swimming pool of water, globally per second. Remember you needed 16 terawatts? 38 terawatts. That's why photosynthesis chose water, the rearranged bonds of water. It knew how much bang for its buck it was getting. So that I want you to understand this. I only need one-third a swimming pool of water globally. I need a hamburger and sunlight, and if I operate on that thing per second, because I got to get the power, I get 16 terawatts, you're good to go. I don't need any fossil fuels. So that's was very intriguing to us. But I got to talk, what's the hamburger look like? So I'm going to quickly tell you how photosynthesis works without getting into details. Sunlight comes into the leaf. The first thing the leaf does is it says, I don't know what to do with sunlight either. It turns it into moving charge. So when the leaf is hit, when this leaf is getting hit with sunlight, it sends an electron. So when you put a plug in the wall, electrons are coming and moving. So electrons and holes are moving. You can think of it that way. So if I have no charge and sunlight comes and I make an electron, negative charge, I have to make a positive charge. And it goes in opposite directions. Moving electrons and holes is current. So the first thing you should know about photosynthesis, leaves are buzzing with electricity. That's what the leaf does, is it turns it into electricity. Just no wires. Then it takes the electron, so it gets energized. Those energized electron and holes get stored in what's called a cofactor. And it's a metal center, and the center gets charged up by one unit of charge, a second, a third, and a fourth unit of charge. When it gets 4 units of charge, the cofactor operates on water and splits it to oxygen and hydrogen. And if 4 protons and 4 electrons is 2 moles of hydrogen. And it does it in the oxygen evolving complex. So the holes come to this cofactor here called the oxygen evolving complex. It splits it to O2. Water to O2, rearranges the bonds of water to make O2, leaves the 4 protons behind. The electrons are in another part of the membrane. The protons run over there. It's an iron reductase, and it makes hydrogen. So we said, could we make something that works the same way? Sunlight in will do 1 unit of charge, a second, a third, a fourth. We'll store it in cofactors. We'll have to make special catalysts. Once they get charged up, they operate on water, split it to make oxygen and hydrogen. And we did. It turns out that compound, when it gets energized by 4 holes, 4 positive charges, it splits water to O2. This compound, which is an alloy, nickel molybdenum zinc alloy or a copper phosphorus alloy, when it gets 4 electrons, it can take the 4 protons from water splitting and make hydrogen. So we invented those catalysts. Okay, now scientists can be awake and everybody else can go asleep. I'm only going to tell you quickly, because there's an important thing. We spent, it's all published in his journal, by the way, Jack's, all these discoveries. We spent years building this catalyst, and it has all the properties of what the oxygen evolving complex has, but it has one super special one. It's self-healing. It fixes itself. And so in Jack's, we have lots of papers, probably too many, as some reviewers have recently told me when his senses pay my papers out. It's giving very detailed mechanism of how this operates. I just want to show you in this huge body of work in Jack's what it does for scientists in the audience. So you can develop rate laws for how you're making oxygen. It's how fast. It's called a rate law. And what it depends on is the different chemical reactants. And it turns out, to make oxygen, this cobalt catalyst has a 1 over H dependence. It's inverse dependent on pH. So you get that blue line. That blue line is saying at pH 7, I need to energize it with holes of the voltage of 1.2 volts. So no different than a battery. I need a battery that's worth 1.2 volts, and I could hook the battery up to this catalyst. It will energize it with four holes, and then it will split water to O2. This red line, it took us years to figure this out, is how the catalyst forms. I need to only put at pH 7 1 volt to make the catalyst do what's called self-assembly. That's actually what Professor Stang studies in his group, self-assembly. So we took those sorts of ideas, and this catalyst spontaneously self-assembles. But it does it with an inverse third order. That just means the slope is steeper. So at pH 7, look at what this is saying. At pH 7, as long as this catalyst is making oxygen, doing its job, like the leaf, it has plenty of energy to fix itself. That's how it forms, by self-assembly. So if some of the catalyst starts breaking down, I have enough voltage. I only need a volt. I'm putting 1.2 volts to drive the catalysis. It can reform itself constantly. So as long as this catalyst is working, it never dies. So for like Matt Sigmund's group, we do catalysis, and it's a finite number. How long does the catalyst go before it dies? And we call turnover number. This catalyst is special. We put the equilibrium for self-assembly inside the catalytic cycle, so its turnover number is infinite. That's really self-healing. We don't have a turnover number. As long as the catalyst is working, it never dies. That's the way you can do it. What else does that mean? This catalyst operates out of, guess what? Boston Harbor, Charles River, puddle on the ground. Why do we spend, remember the poor? If I have to send pure water all over the earth for the poor to use, I'm in trouble. And guess what they're going to do with it anyways? Drink it. Now, because of self, this is what you do in science. You do a basic science discovery. Now, all of a sudden, you can use literally a puddle of water off the ground. So it's one of my requirements for McDonald's. I need to have everything there. You take a puddle off the ground, you look up, there's sunlight. We're just missing that middle piece still, but I'm starting to get the pieces together. What else does it work on? Urine. Why would you do that? Two reasons. If you take urine and split it to O2 and hydrogen, and it's self-healing, so it never dies, what do you get back when you cook it? H2 and O2, pure water. So now I have a distributed, clean drinking water. So that's the science reason, the moral imperative piece. What's the other reason? You find your most annoying graduate student who was yogi at the time, and you get back at him and you say, "Yogi, you're doing the urine experiments." Which I did. Yogi got a faculty position at MIT, so he's doing okay, but I still have that over him. Now I can operate out of any water source. That's good. Now remember, I only have O2. I still have to make the protons, but I already showed you, we figured that out. There's another thing it allows me to do. Because I'm in water, it's not concentrated base or acid, it's not harsh conditions. I can easily integrate to other materials. And I can integrate to biology. And we're going to take advantage of both of these now in my hamburger design. So I have this catalyst, but remember, this doesn't absorb light. It just, when it gets energized by four holes at a voltage of 1.2 volts, it can split water to O2. How do I get light into the system? Silicon, the stuff that's on your roof in a solar panel, that absorbs sunlight, and it separates, it makes moving current. That's why you put wires on it, and that's why when you shine light on a photovoltaic, it runs, you get electricity. So I know that, so we can take silicon, but I don't need to wire it up. I'm just going to have sunlight come into my silicon. We make what's called a junction. This is an end, don't worry about it. We put an internal electric field. You need an internal electric field, because if I make a hole in an electron, and on the, say it's on a plane, then the electrons and holes will run into each other. But think of the electrons and holes as marbles. They'll all be bumping into each other. So I generate an electron and hole with sunlight, and then they just recombine. I waste all the energy thermally. But what I do here is we put an internal electric field chemically by doping the silicon. So now the marbles are on a hill, and it turns out one of the marbles goes uphill, the positive charge, and the negative charge goes downhill. So now when sunlight hits the silicon, the holes go to the top of the silicon, the PP, the end part of the silicon, and down here, the darker part, we put a positive charge so the electrons run there. We get them to separate. Now, it turns out silicon, I told you I need 1.2 volts to split water. I only have 0.5 volts in this thing. So I have to put leads on there because I have to put more electricity in, and that's not good. We'll just use it out of the wall. So we did that, and that's here it is. So here's the silicon with this catalyst on it. It's plugged into the wall, and once I get to 1.2 volts, that downturn means I'm making O2. I'm doing the catalysis. But the difference is this is silicon. So now when I give sunlight to the silicon, I generate an internal voltage of 0.5 volts. So now I don't have to put as much voltage in because the sun is generating a voltage. And you can see here, this is in the dark, but when I turn the sun on, I reduce it by 0.52 volts. I don't have to drive the system as hard with electricity from the wall. That sounds good. This isn't rocket science. That's one junction, 0.5 volts. I need 1.2. Just do the math. How many junctions would I need? Two would get me a volt, three, triple junction. I should generate a voltage that's big enough to separate holes. And that's what we did here. These guys, that silicon's called amorphous silicon. It's just like I told you, and it generates 0.5 volts, an electron and hole. And guess what? It absorbs here at 400 nanometers. And then amorphous silicon, it's silicon and it's a strain lattice. It's amorphous, a silicon strain. And the periodic table, right below silicon, is germanium. It's a bigger atom. So we dope some germanium into the silicon and make a new layer. And that middle part, and we dope enough germanium, and we relax the silicon bonds, and it then absorbs at 600 nanometers. Then we dope more silicon in, and we relax it even more, and it absorbs there. So why did we dope that much silicon with germanium? Why do we choose that? We choose enough to get that plus that plus that. Why do we choose that? Because its absorption spectrum is this. What, 400 nanometers light? Blue light. 900 red light, that absorbs the entire solar spectrum. So when I take this, it's absorbing all the sunlight. So now what's going to happen? Sun comes in here, just like I showed you what the leaf does. It goes into this middle piece, and I generate a hole in electron, and it's absorbing all the sunlight by one unit of charge. Then I do it a second time, a third time, a fourth time. And then once the cobalt catalyst I showed you gets charged up by four holes, out pops O2. It leaves four protons. They run to the other side where the electrons are, just like in the leaf, and they make hydrogen. And it works. After we made this, this was a few years ago. This was the time thing. This is just sitting in my windowsill. There's some silicon with the catalyst on it, and I'm just showing, that's sunlight coming in my front window, and off the front is bubbling oxygen, off the back is bubbling hydrogen. I think this water came from a puddle outside. We just went and got a puddle outside. Now, this is a dumb design, because I'm letting the oxygen and hydrogen mix, but you wouldn't do that. You would just take the hydrogen off, put a separator, and take the oxygen off one side and hydrogen off the other. So I've done the front end of photosynthesis. We call this the artificial leaf. I could distribute it all over the world. You could just go find some sunlight, a dirty puddle of water, and I can then turn it into fuel for you, oxygen and hydrogen. It's a hamburger. I told you it would be. That right there is the meat, this amorphous silicon. Why do we have a piece of cheese in there, ITO? Because you're making oxygen. Oxygen plus silicon makes sand, SiO2. So we protect this silicon with cheese, ITO. That conducts the electron to the top bun, my cobalt catalyst, to make oxygen. The bottom bun makes hydrogen. There's no extra weight in this. I don't have it wired up. I took all the cost of the solar panel out. I'm just using the silicon. It's just layers. I can make this by a thing called chemical vapor deposition. Spray coat surfaces as things running by. It's highly manufacturable. I don't need any electrical engineer to wire it up. I'm just coatings. And then you can drop it in the water and you're good to go. Yay. That's what you say, yay. So I have hydrogen. And we can do it at 13% efficiency, sunlight into hydrogen and oxygen, which is pretty high. So now I'm going to give you hydrogen. What are you going to do with it? Yeah, fuel cells. See, and I know I have scientists and engineers in there. So you could use fuel cells. You're really good to go. What's my problem? I now have to get, remember your existing infrastructure? I now have to convince you to retrofit it with fuel cells. And you don't want to do that, and investors don't want to do it right now because there's no price on carbon, so there's no motivation for them to do that. But you are good to go. What you'll do now with my hydrogen, I guarantee the only thing you can do with it is blow up balloons. Honestly. If I gave you hydrogen right now, you'd just blow up balloons. And if you're not a chemist, you would think it would make your voice go high, but that's helium. So that's all you're going to do with hydrogen. So that's why people are now saying, remember, photosynthesis goes the full distance. If you haven't thought about it, I told you it combines the hydrogen with CO2 in the dark. This is what most people get confused by. The carbohydrate is just a hydrogen storage mechanism. It's not energy storage. The energy storage is all in water splitting. So that's important to know. So what did we do knowing that? And once you have hydrogen, I'm going to show you, this is, gets chemical again, but I'll explain it. That's 4 protons and 4 electrons. That's 2 moles of hydrogen plus oxygen makes water. That's 1.23 volts uphill. I store energy. Once I have that hydrogen, it's energetic enough to react with CO2 to make methanol, which is a fuel. It can make methane. It can make isopropanol, pentanol, butanol. All of those are downhill reactions you can do in the dark. So once I've used sunlight to make hydrogen, all the fuels you use, I can make in the dark with CO2, but not easily. So let me tell you the 3 challenges. This reaction, 4 protons, 4 electrons, what I actually got in the National Academy for, everybody thinks it's for energy. No, I got in for developing the field called proton-coupled electron transfer. It took me 30 years of my life, I didn't get into the details of how a quantum mechanical object, an electron, couples to a more classical object, a proton. And we invented incredibly complicated laser experiments to figure out how electrons and protons talk. And then we put the first theory of proton-coupled electron transfer out there. And then with all that knowledge, after 30 years, I made 1 catalyst that did 4 electrons and 4 protons. And I start looking at these things, 30 electrons, 30 protons. And it's like, whoa, I'm certainly not going to be around to do that. It's all these fuels, if you look at these numbers, they're all the same number, more or less. So it's hard to make one selectively. And that's one carbon, but you got to string a bunch of carbon. These you don't. You're just hydrogenating carbon. But fuels, the stuff in your gas tank, there's a bunch of carbon strung together like pearls on a string. And that's really hard to do. So making carbon-carbon bonds is hard. Doing massive numbers of protons and electrons is hard, and to do it selectively is hard. But I can go to biology because I'm in regular water. I know how to split water using regular water. So we did that. All of that in photosystem 2 up front with the sun is making hydrogen. I now make hydrogen with my artificial leaf. So can I take a bug, a bacterium, genetically encode it to eat hydrogen? Now they're going to be eating hydrogen made from the sun. So it's a way I can trick using sunlight into the bug. And then the bug, can I genetically engineer stuff into it to take the hydrogen and CO2 and make liquid fuel, and it will defecate out fuel? So we took a bug called Ralstonia eutropha, and we did that. So we genetically encoded it with hydrogenases. So now what the bug does, its only food source is hydrogen. We give it no other food. And then it takes the hydrogen, it makes this thing called acetyl coenzyme A metabolically, and from that it makes biomass. But we did something else last year. We put four other genes in the bug. This gene, that gene, that gene, gene 1, 2, 3, 4. Why do we take those genes? Chemistry again. Acetyl coenzyme A looks like this. If I break that bond, I need an enzyme in the bug called the ketothiolase. So we genetically encoded the bug with a ketothiolase. So now its DNA says make ketothiolase. It usually doesn't. That breaks that bond and it joins that carbon with that carbon. That's what biology does with enzymes. Then we genetically encoded it to just add water here, and that breaks this bond. That's what this enzyme does. Then we genetically encoded it to get rid of the CO2, which it does. And then we genetically encoded it to hydrogenate. That's liquid fuel, isopropanol. So these bugs put out isopropanol. I'm going to go through this really quickly. The one thing that annoyed us, when I first published this, I was very upset, because these bugs need to stay alive with 2.8 volts of voltage. I only need 1.2. And what was even more annoying is if I went to lower voltage, they died. And if I electrocuted them, the more voltage I put into them, the more they lived. Okay, that's weird. So that took that you kind of notice. The other thing that bugged us about that, if I have to put 2.5 volts to keep them alive and I only need 1.2 volts, I'm wasting half of my energy to keep them alive. I only need 1.2 volts, but I'm wasting energy to keep them alive with 2.5 volts. So what was going on? This is just a little, again, for the chemist. It turns out in water, the oxygen reduction potential to make superoxide dips below the hydrogen potential. So what was happening is at low voltage, some of my current was making a thing called superoxide and then doing chemistry that's studied here at Utah by this woman in the front row. That goes and gets your DNA, Professor Burrows, and it cleaves your DNA and it leads to mutations and it was killing my bugs. So then I read Professor Burrows' paper and said, that's bad. So I got to get rid of superoxide. And so what we did is we came up with a catalyst that doesn't make superoxide. And these bugs live, and they're very happy. And I can run them at 1.8 volts. So what we do now, this is just showing you what we do. We take a few bugs, throw them in solution. We then use the artificial leaf and split water to make hydrogen. We gave the bugs a way to eat the hydrogen. They suck carbon dioxide from the atmosphere in, and then they go along my genetically engineered pathway, and they defecate out isopropanol. What we do is actually, we let them go into an exponential growth curve. So we only throw a pinch in. Then we just let them multiply wildly. They're bacteria with lipids, biomass. And then we decide, now we want them to go to steady state. So here they're growing wildly, exponentially. That's what's happening here. Then we go steady state. We give them enough hydrogen so some die, and then we replace them with living ones. And so they don't change. And then we take all the extra hydrogen, we send it along that engineered genetic pathway, and they make isopropanol. Yay. Look how much they do it. They do it at 7% efficiency, sunlight into liquid fuel. If we just make biomass, we can make it at 10.2%. The fastest growing crops is 1%. So I just beat out photosynthesis by a factor of 10 with these guys. And I did one thing better. Even with biomass, you got to convert it to a fuel. Here, I let the bugs do it genetically, and I'm doing all the chem engineering inside the bug, and they're making liquid alcohols. Here they're making bioplastic at 8% called polyhydroxybutyrate. I'll show you why I wanted them to do that. So we're way over natural photosynthesis. That's why this year, if you look in the newspapers, you'll find a lot about this. It's because man has beat photosynthesis by a factor of 10. Why is that nice? First off, these things are sucking CO2 out of the air. So I can fix out in one 24-hour period with just the 1-liter reactor this big, I can fix out of 1,200 liters of air, I can fix CO2 to fuel. So it's scrubbing the air, because they have natural CO2 mechanisms called carbonic anhydrases. I don't have, it's not like algae. Algae has to see sunlight. My artificial leaf sees the sun, so these things can be in the dark in the corner, meaning when I build a reactor, I don't have to have the reactor see, every piece of the reactor see the sun, so it's very cheap in engineering design. I'm not competing with crop food land, because my bugs are in a vat over there eating my hydrogen from the sun. I could do this in the desert. So I'm not competing with fuel. And I take 1/10 the footprint of biomass with the best growing crops. So we like that. To end, I just did this with, I put a nose on, I like that because I have a big nose. That's why I did this. Matter of fact, I just took a picture of my own nose and put that on there. So I let the bug now eat hydrogen. It can breathe in hydrogen. That's its energy supply. I'm using the sun indirectly through water splitting to fuel the bug. So, and I genetically can encode it with any factory. That's called synthetic biology. So I just showed you fuels. I could make drugs this way with the right genes. I could make starches, polymers. But what else is in air that you like to have? Nitrogen, fertilizer to grow food for the poor. So can you do that? This isn't published yet. You're getting it before I've published it. We took a bug and we put a gene sequence in, and this bug takes nitrogen with an enzyme called nitrogenases, and it makes ammonia. But then the ammonia, NH3, goes into biomass to make proteins. It's what nature needs. So we let it do that, and we put that in there. And that, a lot of it's natural. We just had to tweak it. I'll show you what we had to do chemically. That the other thing we did is we put in the exact pathway I just showed you to take CO2 plus hydrogen to fuel, but we didn't want fuel. We made a bioplastic called polyhydroxybutyrate. So now I've stored sunlight from water splitting with CO2 in plastic. So now the bug has its own sun bottled inside in plastic. And then what we need to do to get to ammonia is we have to put a small molecule block in one of the metabolic pathways. So some of the ammonia goes on to make proteins to let it live. But then, I'm almost done, Peter. But then we put a block in so ammonia will come out because I want the fertilizer. And so all this is telling you is if we use N15 isotopically nitrogen, it all ends up in the ammonia. It does it at 10 to the 9th. We get 1 billion turnovers per cell. We can assay it by using an assay using ethylene, because some of the nitrogenase makes hydrogen, which we can then turn into from acetylene to ethylene and measure it. So we know each cell is doing 1 billion turnovers before it dies. And that's this part to make ammonia. There's the CO2 plus water to hydrogen, and I'm putting polyhydroxybutyrate in it. So now, once I do that, the bug doesn't need to see the sun, and it doesn't need any more hydrogen, because it's stored it inside. It's its own internal solar energy source. And there it is. So that polyhydroxybutyrate, which came from CO2 in the air, water splitting, gets stored right there in vesicles. So now what can I do? I can take my bugs and put them in the ground, and I can grow crops. Here are radishes. Guess what? Radishes have my solar bugs in the ground, now doing nitrogen fixation from the air. Back there, this is just regular, no fertilizer. Now, you can do that with fertilizer. But again, you have to do Haber-Bosch in a big chemical plant. I'm doing this in your backyard with my little bugs and my little artificial leaf. And I can grow crops. I can grow big radishes. And we are. So this is in the Harvard Arboretum. We're growing big radishes. Students, good business model. Radishes? What else could you grow?
Tomatoes.
No. Massachusetts just became a marijuana state. I can grow totally renewable pot. People who smoke pot, I can price my pot 10 times greater than the market right now. This is going to be a massive business proposition for me. So Drew Faust, my president, doesn't know this, but radishes out, big marijuana plants are going to be inside. Okay, so just to end, I just want you to get, there's a lot of science here. All published in JAX, first PCET. We spent years timing electrons and protons to build self-healing catalysts that allow me to interface the materials, to build the artificial leaf, and now it's synthetic biology, to just use air. My only starting materials are sunlight, air, and water. That's it, if you think about it. And then I'm doing all this. So why a university again? How do I get this to the poor? So I have all this IP, that's called intellectual property. Harvard has it. So the first thing is I convince Harvard not to own it, to give it away. So I've done that. And now I can give it to places like the Institute of Chemical Technology, some of the best chemical engineers in the world, ICT, in Mumbai. So now they can own all Harvard's IP. And if they go start companies and investors, they own it. I don't own it. Harvard doesn't own it. But they still need money. So first we can get investors. But the other thing I can do, and this is what a university allows you to do, I can go over to Harvard Kennedy School and talk to one of the foremost Indian economists, Rohini Pandey. And she, with Michael Greenstone at University of Chicago, her friend and my friend, you can then start monitoring how much carbon people are putting in smokestacks in India. And they're world experts at setting up what are called cap and trade to generate revenue that can get them fit into ICT to take all this free IP and scale it up to pilot scale in under 2 years. And then get Indian investors, and whatever they invest, they own. So if they're wealthy and they own a company, because Harvard's not going to own the IP, if they help them, they can share and they own the IP. And so I'm doing that right now. And I wouldn't be able to do that outside of a university. If I were in a company, they would be hoarding the IP. And they wouldn't know how to do this. And if I were in a federal government, they would do cap and trade, but they have no way to do the discovery. So nothing works. This only works at a university this quickly. So that's another reason to use the whole university, even if you're a scientist. Okay, I'm ending, and I promised the freshmen I spoke to, some of them worried about climate change, some weren't, not important. I'm just saying in the next 40 years, you better be worried about it. And I want to talk about one guy just before he died I got to know, because I do public stuff, Kurt Vonnegut. And he, remember I told you about solipsism? He was the biggest anti-solipsist in the world. He could see the entire world, not just the world he lived in. I think that's why his books were so famous. And this is something he taught me just before he died. And this is going to make you all feel really happy. That's why I want you to do this. He explained to me, Dan, the planet is a living organism. And like all living organisms, they have immunological systems. So when you get sick and there's some invading organism, your immune system kicks in and eliminates, these were his words, eliminates the irksome intruders when sufficiently compromised. And then he said, the planet is a living organism. And as we choose a path to suffocate the planet in CO2, we need not worry. The planet's immunological system will respond and just simply kill us all, just like any good living organism. And the planet's going to be just fine. So when you're really getting upset, if you don't, then you're always happy. But if you're a neurotic like me, the way I feel happy at night is I just say, and I can't stand it when people say, oh my God, what are we doing to the planet? You're doing nothing to the planet. She's just going to kill you all if you're really abusive to her. And she's going to be fine. And that's what makes me feel happy at night. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention. My answer is thank you.
Thank you very much. We have time for a few questions.
How did you get Harvard to relinquish the patent?
Here's a good academician. So how did we get Harvard to relinquish the patents? So Harvard and Utah shouldn't relinquish patents on IT or pills, pharma, because IT is low capex, so you can get investors. Pharma, you can get investors. It's expensive as hell, actually, when you go through FDA. But like I said, you'll pay for hope, so you can get investors. But I just told you, energy's high capex. To go to market with my flow battery, we're talking quarters to half a billion dollars. And so you're not going to get investors, and there's no carbon pricing. So what do we do? This is what I convinced Harvard. This is going to sound terrible, and this is being taped. Turn the tape off. So what does Harvard do with undergraduates? Drew can't stand when I talk about undergraduates this way. I'm going to talk as an economist. They treat them as future assets. So what do I mean by that? I have no idea which one of these kids from Utah right now is going to hit it big. So you're just nice to all of them with the hope that's a future asset, that they will come and bestow huge amounts of money on you. Right? That's what you do. And that's what Harvard does with their undergraduates. You come to Harvard, you're in Disneyland. When you leave, Disneyland is fun. You remember it, and then you come back to Disneyland for your honeymoon or when you have kids. And so when you become wealthy, come back to Harvard, and this is what they hope, and they give them lots of money. So I convinced Harvard to treat IP, at least in energy, as a future asset. Then you don't have to cover it. To go to market, you're going to have to go up against people like Lockheed Martin at the end of the day anyways. So treat it like a future asset. And if people from India become super wealthy on it, I have no doubt someday Harvard will benefit from it. And it was that easy. And they said, oh my God, no, sir. After they understood this CapEx argument, they said, all right, we'll treat your IP this way. And I think that's how all universities should treat IP and energy personally.
Yeah. Other questions, comments? Yes, back there.
How far reaching is your product currently?
Yeah, so my water splitting, you know, the artificial leaf, basically dead in the water here in this part of the world because of fracking. So let me tell you, I could make hydrogen at around $5 per kilogram of hydrogen with this technology. And 5 years ago, that was pretty good because a kilogram of hydrogen is equal to energy of 1 gallon of gasoline. But because of fracking now, you get hydrogen at $1.50. So that totally took out that market, but not in the developing world necessarily. And then in terms of the last part of going to liquid fuels, that's what I'm doing with ICT now. We're building the reactors. And you got to really build it, finally, to know, understand really cost and price. Yeah. Over here. Yeah, go.
Who at Chicago is doing the estimates of the carbon infrastructure? I'm an economist.
Good. Yeah, so Michael Greenstone is. And then there's a woman, and I'll get you her name. She's from Jim Anderson's group at Harvard. And she's actually in earth and planetary sciences, but has an economics degree. And she's really dug in, giving the science piece to the right economists at Harvard. And I'll give you her name. And she hasn't published it yet. So this number is a number I'm giving. But she's really thinking hard with these economists to just get what the CapEx cost of our infrastructure is. The other way to say it, to answer your question also in the back, if 100 years ago you had, I'm going to tell you this is way cheaper than what you're doing now, because 100 years ago, if you had to say, make the investment on fossil fuels or this type of science, this is way cheaper. But not after you spent $12 trillion or $8 trillion it isn't. Sure. So look at, talk about GMO problems. But you know what you do as a scientist? I mean, we should have that discovery for the fertilizer. For the energy stuff, it's all self-contained. I'm not worried about it. It's literally what you do now anyways. They're vats. It's more a chem engineering project. But then taking bugs and burying them in the ground, I may be on the edge of lunacy, and I don't want to fight that. The real issue was, can I do it? So we make nitrogen by a thing called Haber-Bosch at huge centralized plants, and then you have to have the entire infrastructure to distribute the fertilizer. So I just showed you, you can do Haber-Bosch in your backyard and then actually grow things with it. So that's how I was trying to do, and now we get to a different level. How do you actually move forward with this? And it probably would make my head explode at this point. But of course, I would have to deal and worry about that. And would I say this is a way to do crop fertilization? I'm not sure. You can kind of see what I was really interested in was this idea, literally, could I swear, the thing I wanted to do is just say, can I use as my starting materials as a chemist, sunlight, air, and water, to make two important things, fuels and fertilizer. So I think we've shown that now.
Other questions? One or two more?
Over here in the front, yeah. Yeah.
And I assume you have gone to India because fracking has taken hold in
here.
This country.
Sure.
Its infrastructure.
Yeah.
How do you suggest we become more enlightened with some approach that allows the economics to support your discovery?
Yeah. The only way you can do that, I believe, in this country quickly is to price carbon, tax carbon. I really believe that. And I just don't think this country is ready for that yet. Now, they should be. Because you know what's going to happen when you do see water rising and it starts infiltrating most of your financial centers? We'll deal with it. You're going to hire big engineering firms, and you're going to build dams off the coasts of your New York City, and you're going to make sure that water doesn't get there, and it's going to cost tens and tens and tens, maybe hundreds of billions of dollars. And then you guys are all breathing in carbon, and most of our asthma, and so much of, that's where the School of Public Health is. They've been putting real cost of carbon and particulates on the health system. So when you finally start, I really think it's an economics argument, not a climate argument for this country, because of this paid off infrastructure. And when you start doing that, the price of carbon starts adding up pretty quickly, but we'll deal with it in a catastrophic way. And there is a catastrophic way right now in our public health system, but we haven't put a value on it yet. So that's why I really think a university is important. Is if you're interested in energy, I love talking to School of Public Health and economists to help me keep understanding more deeply what the real price of carbon is. But it's also the only way that's going to happen here in this country is tax it. And we're just not going to do it right now. And it's not to get angry at them, because I just showed you money, GDP, scales with energy use. The current administrations, it's not that I don't believe they're anti-climate. Some of them aren't, but not the ones you hear. Most of them aren't, including our president. He's just worried about the economy. He's saying, come hell or high water, I'm not doing anything to stop it. So I value the climate more than he does. He values the economy. To understand that, I think, is important when you're listening to, it's not a political, I'm going to say it in a different way. I've met very, very few climate change deniers. I've met a lot of people worried about the economy and not so worried about climate change. That's a different argument.
Okay.
One more back there.
Yeah.
As somebody from India, I would say this is incredible. This is
yeah.
The most amazing technology, and I thank you for it.
Sure.
So I'll ask the last question. Do you believe everything you see on Google?
Yep.
Thank you very much, and thank you all for coming. The next Frontiers of Science lecture will be Thursday, April 20th, by Frank Brown, our former dean of college, and he's going to talk about the Omo-Turkana Basin, East Africa, a treasury of history. And our next Science Night Live lecture will be Wednesday, April 5th. Thank you again all for coming.